You want any food, Johnny?
Some Maccas.
You want some Maccas?
Fuck, that just shows you how fucking hard it is.
You swim the channel, then you gotta climb Everest. Where's he going, Matt? Right, as far back as the slick can go. Put it as far back as it can go. Why don't you just fly across the back? What do you want to do, John?
Put him in the front. I don't think we've got room.
I'll just back. Push it back to me.
Let me get him.
John's literally superhuman as far as I'm concerned.
He will push himself to the very, very end.
I've never trained with anybody who trains that hard and that fast.
He wants to get something, he'll go after it as hard as he can.
He's reached levels that no human being has ever done.
He's an extraordinary athlete.
He's the greatest endurance athlete of all time, anywhere bar none.
John does what he does simply because he can.
I saw the effort. I saw the day he said, I'm going to do this, and went on a 70K run New Year's Day. What were you doing New Year's Day? He was running 70Ks and back.
What time do you set off, John?
Just after 5 this morning.
And what about the other days?
About the same, 4:35. Try and leave early, get it done.
Well, Johnny, is that the hardest you've run
nah.
In 3 days?
Oh, it is for 3 days, yeah. I've done a few 70s, so that's probably the most I've done in 3 days. It's 150K in 3 days, plus had a couple of swims.
And you look fantastic.
Oh, no, it's getting easier. These runners are good. I'm happy with these runners. So, see,
well, they're great, man. Hey, look at him. He's not even broke sweat. Look at that broke sweat. Good,
oh, man.
So what are you doing now, John? Big breakfast?
Yeah, have brekkies, put the feet up, have a shower.
Good, man. You're not training anybody this afternoon, are you?
No, it's Queen's birthday. So thank you.
Oh, yeah, Queen's birthday. We're having a party, aren't we?
To your side of the
fence.
Yeah,
so the Queen.
God bless the Queen. Get a day off, Your Majesty. So,
All right, Johnny. Good man, Johnny. So, that's a fantastic. What were you drinking here?
Oh, I started off with Ribena, and then obviously I had to refill it, so I just put water in. And I brought some muesli bars.
Yeah.
Just brought some. Whatever, muesli bars.
Did you eat this morning before you went?
No, I just had a sesame seed bar.
Fantastic.
Just cheapo bars. Brilliant. Just get the sugar up.
So you got about 10 weeks?
Yeah, still a lot of training.
So you're on track? So
people say it's not long to go. I'm thinking, you just spend 1 week training with me and then you'll see what you think.
Yeah.
So it's still a long time. But looking forward to the challenge.
Good man, John.
Go and have your country.
Good man, John. We'll be there.
Hey.
Arch to arch.
Hey.
The Enduro Man is a 140-kilometre run from the Marble Arch of London to Dover, then swimming the English Channel, 33 kilometres if you do a straight line.
After you swim the English Channel, you then ride 290Ks to the Arc de Triomphe. And the clock starts when you leave the London Arch and it is on continually until you ride to the steps of the Arc de Triomphe along the Champs-Élysées in the centre of Paris.
In 1997, my dad actually came up with the idea for John to try this ultra triathlon. There had been rumours floating around that a company was offering, I think it was like £1,000 or maybe it was £1 million, I'm not sure, for the first person that could go from Paris to London. And so I started to look into the logistics and became a bit of a family project for a little while. And I actually put together this particular document here, which, as you can see, it shows that it's the reverse way from what John ended up doing. But so the seed to do the event was planted way back in 1997.
we were very competitive when we were young. We had a lot of big fights and, you know, training together. We ended up, we couldn't train together. We had to go, you know, different squads because we just kept fighting in the lane. And, you know, and before I could drive, Tammy would try and kick me out of the car and make me walk home. She was upset I did something, you know, I wouldn't let her pass me in the pool or something like that. Oh, she's great. You know, Tam and I get on really well. And she's always got my back. Yeah, she's an awesome sister.
John and I went over to do the channel in 1993 together, and our aim was to be the first brother and sister to cross. And we did a lot of pre-training. We swam across Port Phillip Bay in the lead-up. The difficulty was is that John didn't want to take any advice on board, and he didn't want to gain any weight because one of the biggest threats with the English Channel is hypothermia, and that's when your core body temperature drops just 4 or 5 degrees, and it can actually have very serious ramifications, hypothermia. So the goal was to put on about 10 kilos, which I managed to do, but John at the time decided that his goal was to be the skinniest and the fastest person across the channel.
I remember the first time I got there, I did a 2K training session with Tammy, and I got out shivering. I thought, oh, this is not a good sign. And I thought in my head that, you know, that if I just dealt with a cold, you know, I just wouldn't let it stop me. And so the plan was, I didn't care how cold I got, I'd just keep charging through. And we had a bad window in 93. It was, yeah, it was 4-6 winds, it was big waves, the water was quite cold.
And on board our boat, or as part of our support staff, was actually Dawn Fraser. And Dawn's been a wonderful mentor to both myself and John. And she actually was on board John's boat when we did the channel crossing together.
And I was swimming very well through the chop. It was, you know, it was good chop. It was big waves, but you could smash through it and get a rhythm.
But as soon as I got back to the boat, my crew informed me that John had actually been pulled out of the water with hypothermia 4 kilometres away from the coast of France, and that he was unconscious.
What happens with hypothermia is the first stage is you're cold and you're shivering, and then you go past that. So I actually thought that I was okay because I kind of stopped shivering, and that's actually the worst stage of hypothermia.
He'd stopped breathing, and Dawn had actually been the one that had jumped into the water and pulled him back on board the boat. And Dawn actually broke 3 ribs in the process of pulling John back on board the boat. And then she resuscitated him. So he was only young and very, very skinny. So it was a very horrific experience.
Quite upset that that happened to me. I couldn't believe, you know, because I thought I was fit and strong and kind of mentally rocked me a little bit, and I stood on it for quite a while. And but you know, after a while, you got to get back. You can't live like that.
Since then, he's become the youngest and fastest swimmer across Port Phillip Bay. He's become the fastest Australian across the English Channel. He has performed the double crossing of the English Channel in under 20 hours. He has won the New Zealand Half Ironman, and he's won the most prestigious international distance swimming race in the world, the 47 Ks around Manhattan Island, New York City, 3 times.
We know Johnny's background as an elite performer, as a channel swimmer, as a coach. He gives people advice all the time about knowing your limit. And then he goes and sets a limit that's way above the limit of any other person that he deals with.
John keeps things very close to his chest, and he doesn't tell people really what's going on with his health and with his mind and what he's experiencing. So I knew that that was all going to play a big factor, and that John would just keep going.
It's an incredibly demanding event, and you have to be prepared for medical contingencies. It's silly to do otherwise.
As a sister, and you know, I only want John to be successful, but you know, there comes a point when you think, oh no, don't push it to that point.
But it's the ability to get that little bit extra out of yourself that makes you an elite performer, and to know your own body. That's why he spent the hours and hours on Beach Road, the hours and hours running up and down doing those Ks, and the hours in the bay doing the stuff, because he knew he was going to face this situation.
Once you get to Calais, medical check, so we probably...
Is that a requirement, event in general?
No, but I think we're going to need to have a doctor just, like, you know, Johnny's going to be pushing himself pretty hard. I think we've got to basically factor into the equation that we probably need to have doctors on standby at various points, that they can actually do a medical check on him and actually see how well he's going, because...
That'd be right.
Seriously. You mate, you might think you're going to be right, if I put this together and then you fall off your perch because you bloody pushed the shit out
of
yourself.
What's the doctor going to do? Just give you advice.
Take your blood pressure, buddy. Just listen to your heart. Make sure.
We don't want anyone negative. Anyone's going to like try and stop me. We don't want them there.
No, I want no doctor. So, why would I want a doctor there for? What's a doctor going to do? And
so we're giving John an hour and a half from when he gets to Dover.
Yeah. So he goes from the London Arch to Dover, from Dover to the Saltwood, and then Saltwood back to Dover.
Correct.
Okay.
So, but we drive him from Dover to Saltwood.
Now you'll have your international license. I mean,
I'm okay.
That's all suggesting that John runs the run in. How long did we say?
We said John would run for Depart Marble Arch, arrived over. We've got 14, is that?
6 minute Ks is 14 hours.
Yeah.
I'm doing my 50K in 4.5 K pace.
Bloody hell. You're a machine.
Depends how much I've
So what happens when you guys go to Depart Dover on the swim leg, me and Dad will jump on the ferry with both vehicles, get to the other side, which is going to be Calais, which is where you're aiming for, and then just be ready. So we'll be on the sat phone to you.
And we will call you to confirm where the where to meet.
Yeah. So you might finish all the way down the coast, wherever you do finish, and then we'll try and pick you up as close as we can to where you actually finish.
Swim, we've allowed
11 hours. Yeah, just
yes,
in
11
case.
Hours.
Unless I get a bad tide. But
so it's worst case. Okay, so what do you think would be a good time for you? An average sort of the time.
8 or 9 hours.
Yeah. Okay.
It all depends on how we go with the how he goes with the tides.
Mm-hmm.
How will your legs be after 140 k?
They'll be
knackered. My point is,
that's a stupid question.
And if not. We've got that rib boat,
speedboat
option, to get you to as close as we can to us, to transport you to Calais.
Yep.
Does that all make sense?
Yep.
I think.
And just so you two guys know, we'll pick him up.
Yep.
And one of us will then take him to the accommodation.
So you're saying to him at this stage, how much rest do you need? Fair question. He's gone 31 hours. Yeah. Probably worst case scenario, because at that stage that puts him well in line to smash the record, doesn't it? To smash it.
If he
needs to have an extra hour or two, it doesn't really matter.
Exactly, So if you need another hour or two, then you'll probably still break the world record by 15 hours.
If you can conserve on the run, because you've got time up your sleeve at the other end.
Because we're so fixed with our high tide time.
It's nailing the run.
If the high tide was...
Yeah. He's got to nail the run in terms of being conserved in the application of his energy.
Yeah, but also to ensure that he makes the high tide.
Which you should do.
Can I ask a dumb question? Do you need a massage? Can any of you guys do massage if you're leaving?
Oh, no, I'm out of that.
Hi, Johnny.
Good to meet you, mate.
Great to see you. Great to see you.
The Royal Navy Royal Marines triathlon team. A challenge was set where they would relay between London and Paris into services, so the Navy would go against the Army, Air Force and so on, and the GB men, GB women were also racing. I thought, what a fantastic idea. So I swam the English Channel in 89, which was tough for me without a wetsuit, I was a triathlete. Once I'd done that, I realised then, now's the time to try and do this London to Paris for myself. I started training again, and I did it the following year.
And what year was that?
91 I was successful.
91
so,
yeah, the very first arch.
Yeah, held the record until Mark Bayliss got it.
The record's currently held by an Englishman called Mark Bayliss, and he set it at 72 hours something. So I'm going to try and knock that off.
The one that I got, which became a Guinness Book of Records thing because it was the first one, in 81 hours and 5 minutes.
We're now at the stables in Saltwood, in the south of England, about 20k from Dover. This has been the home of the John Van Wees camp. They've been here for Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 6 days, and this has probably got the first day of his window late in the day, and it's pouring down. And this morning, unbelievably, they got a call from the Enduro man and the boat man saying the weather forecast for the next week looks very grim and there isn't a possibility of a window. So about 10 o'clock this morning, it was off. John's unbelievable attempt to be the Enduro man to break the record was off. Anyway, in the last hour, they've had a call from Edgar, Enduro man, saying, and the boatman saying, there's a possible chance tomorrow night, so we have a small window. So now, inside the house, they're preparing food. John's got all his meals to eat. They're preparing his shoes, his bike, everything, to start at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning in Marble Arch.
Logistically, we've got a pop-up toilet tent, a porta-potty, sleeping bag pillow, sleeping bag sheets, so I can fold down two of the back seats in the van, an inflated thermarest, a self-inflating mat, so that way he can have a lie down if he wants to. Big first aid bag, including everything from, including a defibrillator if his heart stops. Two bags of drinks, run drinks. With one of the bags of run drinks, we actually have taped to the side salt tablets, so if he's starting to cramp up, to help him to prevent cramping up. The drinks is everything from water to flat coke to Powerade to Ribena. The food, he's planning for the first half of the run to be operating on these access bars, which he can't have any sugar with, he can only have water. And for the second half, we've got everything from peanut butter and jam sandwiches to fruit, muesli bars, to stewed apple, stewed pear, coffee, baked beans. So it was really a logistical exercise, but we're just about there and we're raring to go for tomorrow. Go, Johnny!
Once we decided to go, I was full steam ahead. So once I've made that decision in my head, it's go, there's no stopping. So I know there was a lot of rumblings, you know, behind, and my sister was emailing me, telling me not to go, and you know, Robbie wasn't sure. But once we made that decision, you just got to go, and there was no looking back after that. And I was just ready to go, no matter what came up. It's just the luck of the draw, and so be it. That's all part of racing.
Well, it's the 26th of August, and it's race day for John Van Wees arch to arch attempt. It's 5 o'clock in the morning. It's pretty dark. It's not raining, which is a great sign. We're going inside now to the camp where they're just finishing up with breakfast and getting ready to prepare John for this great challenge.
The last breakfast. You look good.
Thanks, man. You too.
Fucking kill him. So what have we got for the breakfast? Porridge?
Big Johnny Locke's specialty. Porridge, blueberries, sultanas, honey, all top 10 food groups apparently. Mm.
Now, this weather, you'd be used to this weather, wouldn't you, from Melbourne? You've run in this weather lots of times.
This is like a nice weather, a nice Melbourne day.
Yeah, yeah, it'd be good for you, better than the sun and hot.
Yeah, I actually like running in the cold, so it's cold that. And overcast.
Yeah,
so fantastic. I like that, I hate the heat. See you.
This is it, Johnny.
That's it. See you, guys.
Where's Johnny? Oh, there he is. The Royal Way.
This is the way you've driven it.
Yeah.
Well, we arrived at Marble Arch in London, and look at this weather. It's perfect for John. He's turned it on. We've got half an hour to go. John is here already making a few friends. Word has got around. Even India. People have come from India to see John off. It's unbelievable the power of this man's popularity.
I'll start him and we'll make tracks down. But he's ready. We're going to start any minute. He's just getting his trousers off now.
The only thing you've got to do, John, I'm guiding you anyway for the first 10, but you'll keep straight. Yep. If you're in the whole court, you keep going straight unless one of us turn you left or right.
Yep.
If you're not sure, you stop, use that phone.
All right.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go.
Well done.
08:15 start.
From the Marble Arch in London on August 26, 2014 at 8:15, the great man began his enduro event attempt. Go, Johnny.
Straight under the bridge. Yep.
The run is not important. The only really important thing is to get down to Dover in a fit state to swim. If he fails to swim, it's all forgotten. Even if he walks, I've not seen in 14 years somebody run the whole way. Right. Nobody has run the whole way. So if John runs the whole way and he's having the shortest rest by far than anybody that's ever done it before, I would say that he would fail to swim, even with his quality.
Edgar's great. He's a very honest, straight-up man. And he's telling us, you know, the times he heard that we were saying, you know, you're kidding yourselves and this and that. So I thought about it for a while, and because I'd never run 140, I thought, well, maybe he's got some merit in it. And then I stood on it, I thought, nah, stuff it. It's just, let's go for it. You know, it's a risk. If you want to get a record, you've got to take risks.
Basically, England is getting the backlash of a hurricane that hit America or is up there. And the weather has just been so in and out. Nobody's been able to predict anything. John's lucky because his run is going to be quick, and so the gap between his run and his swim is the shortest that we've ever known in Enduroman. The window's still open, and it looks as though it's going to stay. The further down we get, the more optimistic I am. But the reality is, it could still close, and we'll get down there, and it won't be safe to put him in the water.
Right, we've got a problem now.
So he's come up here. Make sure you see him.
All right.
All right, if you don't, you're going to have to call him.
Right.
Have you got him on? Have you got a camera?
Right, we've got a problem now. We've lost John because we've had to stop. Is that them in front, Mike, as well?
I don't think it would have got him.
No, they're behind us.
I don't know.
No, we've fucking lost him.
He's gone straight on.
Yeah. He went straight on. Well, we just stopped at a checkpoint just to check everything with Enduroman, and John's gone off, but we think he might have turned at the wrong junction. But luckily John's got a phone on him, so hopefully we can phone him and get him back. Now, we just got to a point where we've lost John because we sent him the wrong way, unfortunately. There's roundabouts, it's busy traffic here, and we've carried on further. Enduroman has gone on his bike to find John to bring him back. So hopefully, he's here now. Johnny! He's here now. Well done, John.
Brother,
back
there.
Johnny, what an egg.
Sorry about that.
Well done, boys.
The hop is done, John. You're out of time. All right. Now.
Yeah.
It's an extra mile for no reason.
I know. Sorry, John.
I said, these things happen, and it was annoying me, and I couldn't get out of my head for, you know, for the whole, still can't. Still annoys me, but like I said, it's all part of it. There's always, nothing ever goes perfect, and, you know, had to deal with it at the time, and then it's all part of it.
Wag, you've never seen anything like this.
I've seen a couple of others starting off at this pace. If John can maintain it, that will be phenomenal.
What's happening, Johnny?
Well, he's going to have a shoe change. He's going to have a vest, and he's going to be eating hard food for the first time, and he's going very well.
Great John Van Wees. These are unbelievably shocking conditions, but he just ploughs on. He just ploughs on. The man is on a mission.
I just got word that the conditions are looking okay for the channel.
Yep.
And it's all go ahead for the moment. Looking at about 8 a.m. takeoff from Dover.
Is this the longest you've ever run then, Johnny, yeah. One go? That's quality. Hey?
Wasn't no horse, there wasn't no running, mate. I wish I could have that 3 or 4k back that I lost.
Yeah,
back
I know.
I knew it was nearly today.
It was a disaster, man.
Oh. And then it's not hard enough.
Yeah, I know. So Johnny Dover's here.
Oh, thank God.
You're getting the bus and walking.
Oh, I might take the bus.
Come on.
We'll head your name.
We'll see you at the finish. Johnny. Mm-hmm.
The pizza on the way?
Pizza's on the way, Johnny. All right, Johnny, off you go.
Thanks,
Johnny. Tippy hasn't done enough running, Brooksy. Yay! Go, Johnny! Go!
Hey! Hey, Johnny! Walk in the park! Hey. Oh. Walk in the park, Johnny! High five, son!
Let's go home.
Awesome man! Awesome man! Well done! Well done!
Have a rest, hey?
Three cheers for Johnny Van Wees, hip hip.
Hey! It's amazing, he said he was going to do 16 hours and he did 15 hours 53 minutes, so he couldn't have timed it any better. Yeah, I'm really impressed.
Well, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. John had to be literally carried in the house. He's had a bath, he's now asked for something to eat. And he's sat up in bed. We're going to see if I can have a couple of words with him. Can I have a look, John?
Oxy.
Yeah. How are you, John? Hi, Jim. Look at that. The food for champions.
You got one with Susie.
Hey? Yeah, just give him a massage, Steve.
Yeah, I've just done his calves. I'm just about to do his. What am I doing now?
Service. Make some eggs, massage.
Magnificent.
Hold you out of the bar.
Hey, I cook the toast, John.
Oh?
I cook the toast.
Oh, thanks.
Well, I put the bread in.
Tell me if I'm going to do that.
Alright. Anyway.
I must admit, I felt pretty bad when I woke up. Went downstairs and I tried to mask that I was okay to the crew. Sat down and everyone was in the kitchen. I could hear them all happy and getting supplies ready, and I just felt really crook in the guts. And it's a strange feeling, because you're that exhausted. It's just a total contradiction, that you feel like eating but you can't, and you feel like sleeping but you just kind of, it's like sleeping in an airplane. You get kind of broken sleep. I downed probably 4 litres of water just to try and flush it out, and I knew that once I got in the channel, I was horizontal, that I'd probably feel better. So, you know, like I said, I didn't expect to feel good during this event, and so you just roll with the punches and whatever it is, you know, it is.
He did the run hard and went into deep recovery and had to receive a little bit of assistance after the race, because it's amazing how quickly your body closes down.
How long has he slept, John?
Well, he hasn't had a lot of sleep, but I'd say hopefully he's had 4.5-5 hours.
Right.
But I never thought I'd have to carry a 92-kilogram man up 2 flights of stairs, but I managed to do it.
And
had
collapsed.
Big Steve Cummings. Yeah, he went into a very sort of relaxed state. He was a little bit sick.
Yeah.
But he's got over that, Johnny. He's got tremendous resolution.
Yeah.
He's a man of great mental courage.
Swim leg, John.
He faces a task today. I mean, swimming the English Channel after you run 140 Ks, in that time, he'll be the only human to have achieved that.
There.
Oh, Johnny.
Well, it's 8 a.m. and John has just gone on the boat round at the marina. They're going to bring him round here at Shakespeare Beach, drop him off, and this is where he officially starts the swim. And you've heard from Enduro Man that this is going to be a tough swim. No one else is swimming this week.
Yeah, well, he shouldn't be swimming this week at all, actually, but and he's got no chance of swimming next week, so he's plugged for the fact that we're trying to do something.
But now or not at all?
No other person was out there. He was the only swimmer out there. He's probably the only person in the world that could have actually got across on that day. Tammy was making the call not to go, and I was extremely worried about it.
And my advice was no. When I heard that the channel window was only an hour and what kind of conditions John was going to be facing, I just thought that it wasn't worth rolling the dice and gambling on such a small window to get across.
When Tammy says don't go and everyone else has cancelled and here's John battling tiredness, you were very worried about him, very worried about him. I mean, I've known him since he was 15. I was worried about him.
The point is, are you ever going to feel good after 140k running? I've broken the course record. I've never run 140. You know, I could have taken another hour off having not gone off course. So I've gone faster than any relay teams run it. You're not going to feel good running 140k. I'm still up for the swim in terrible conditions.
My phone's going off. Skype calls from Tammy, from Rob, basically just trying to tell me, don't go.
Once Matt and I decided to go, that was it, you know. The button's been pushed and we're just going.
So you were deliberately ignoring your sister because she might have talked you out of it, would she?
Yeah, well, Tam, I didn't want to get an ear bashing. I just ran 140 and Tam, she doesn't stop. So she was sending me emails telling me not to go. And, you know, once we decided, I didn't want to waste energy. I just wanted to do it and concentrate on the task at hand. And so it was all full steam ahead.
John ended up making the decision to go, so he set off. And from that moment on, I guess panic stations at the back of my mind, I knew that he was going to be facing a huge battle to get across the channel.
If he gets across, which I'm sure he will, but if he, you know, it'd be a channel swim and a half.
Well, that is gold. We've got all the police force here, we've got them all out on the beach. Apparently what has happened, they thought that John was an illegal immigrant coming off the boat swimming on shore. Because they thought he had a black suit on, it was a black wetsuit. So the police was out there with the guns to arrest John Van Wees for being an illegal immigrant before he's even started swimming to France. That's hilarious.
Is he not well or something?
Excuse me, can you just tell us what has happened here? This is hilarious. Did you think he was illegal immigrant?
There was a report they might have been.
Illegal immigrant?
Yeah, that was the initial report.
So this is a day when no boatman will take any of their swimmers out. That's how bad it is. That says something within itself. The tides are strong, he's on a spring tide. Then you've got winds that are fierce, which are creating a chop, a nasty chop. And when you're in the water swimming, to have a headwind and a chop that's hitting you constantly, it literally is like being in a boxing match. It's like being punch drunk. You know, it's like someone's continually punching you.
And the problem with that is that basically, because the water's moving a lot more, you're actually travelling a lot further from Shakespeare Beach to Cape Grenier, which is in France. That's the shortest possible distance. But relative to the land, you're actually swimming much further. You're swimming up to 50 kilometres, it looks, if you look at the track.
I've summoned bigger waves than that, way bigger waves. It was just awkward chop. It's the kind of chop where your legs in one spot, your head's in another spot. It's just your body's in all different angles. And as a swimmer, you like to get in a rhythm and just start charging. You just get in the zone and off you go. With this, I could never switch my brain off because I was constantly getting ragdolled. It was just very frustrating and annoying kind of chop. And I didn't realise how far I was going off course. And I was confident in my channel ability.
Although the crew obviously had John's best interest at heart and they were, you know, looking after him as best they could, none of them had any sort of hands-on experience of actually being in a channel swim.
He'd be quite capable of just swimming until he passes out, basically. At which point he's done it before, you'd have to harpoon him and haul him into the boat, basically, to save his life.
No, he never complained, he never said anything, and made it much harder for someone who had no idea how to support him when he wasn't really asking for things. I was on the deck of the boat in between feeding stints, and suddenly I heard this noise and a sort of beeping noise, and I was looking all around to see what it was, had no idea.
So I actually found the satellite phone number and managed to get through to Steve on board the boat, which was, the timing evidently was just perfect, because I called him and he straight away said, "Oh, I'm so glad you called. I'm the only one left on deck."
And it was Tammy, Johnny's sister, to wanting an update. She was very worried and she gave me some fantastic tips.
"I'm not sure if I'm feeding John the right things. I haven't done this before. I've been giving him, you know, Ribena mixed with this, and I'm not quite sure if that's the right thing. And he's, you know, his body seems to be shutting down. He's looking tired, he's cold." And at that point in time, I wished I could just be a genie and blink myself over there and be on his boat.
"I spoke to Tammy. She was worried about you."
Oh my God.
So as soon as we started adding hot water to his drinks, it gave him a whole new lease of life, and he was just powering on. It made a huge difference.
We're in Calais waiting at our accommodation, resting, and we're looking at the tracker, so the Enduroman tracker on the website, because that's the only form of communication we have at the moment, because the satellite phone isn't really working, no phones are working out there on the channel. So we're looking at the tracker, and Edgar, the Enduroman himself, says to us, "Probably going to take him about 15 to 18 hours to get across, if he actually does even make it across."
"He's just pulling himself out of the water, which is amazing."
John is now swimming for his life. If he doesn't succeed in what he's trying to do here, it's all over for him. The current is unpredictably, unbelievably strong. He's deep in his reserves. There's a very big question mark about whether or not he's going to be able to get to the French coastline.
"500 yards!
Okay. That's good.
Thank you.
solid to the finish.
Lock him, push him out a little bit. There. Come on. Johnny, come over.
Johnny, Johnny, push, over! Push,
put the light
just,
over.
Wrong way, left!
Right, left!
Left,
go
your left.
Left.
Johnny, left, come back!
Is
he
alright there, mate?
Is he right there? Johnny, back here! Straight now, John, come to your right.
How close
to
Norway's gonna be?
Where's he going there? Johnny, left, come back! Swim this morning at 8:30 in Dover Harbour, and now just a few minutes past 10 o'clock, he's about to complete his epic journey. The swim time approximately about 12 hours and 30 minutes. His hands go above the head. That's it. He has reached shore. John Van Wisser, it is official. It is official.
Johnny!
I could see the lighthouse on the right-hand side of me on this big row of rocks, and I thought we were actually getting swept that way, so I thought, stuff this, so I started charging towards the lighthouse, and all of a sudden I realised that I wasn't getting any closer, and I thought, oh no, and then I heard Mike, you know, going, you effing idiot, you've effed up, swim back to the boat, you effing idiot, this and that, and thought, oh no.
He's actually gone the wrong side. He was aiming for the lighthouse. He needed to have come to the right to get inside the cove where he eventually landed.
He's come back around the right-hand side of me and parked the boat to try and block the tide. So I'm basically swimming right next to the boat, and he's telling me, you know, you've got 500 yards.
And I'm giving it everything,
I'm thinking, because I knew, I knew I was against the tide, and I knew it was a strong tide because I was swimming on the spot when I was heading towards the lighthouse, and I was swimming at a good speed. So I basically knew I had to sprint for my life to try and beat the tide, and had to give every bit of energy I had left in the well, which I didn't want to use, I wanted to save, but I had to dig in and just go for it. And I'm not sure how long it took, but geez, it must have been half an hour to swim that 500 yards, which was just, you know, ridiculous. And even with 10 metres to go, I wasn't sure I could get in.
Had he not been able to achieve what he was trying to do then, had he missed that point when we called him back on a course, it would have been all over for him, because it would have just been too far and too long to go.
So I land on this rock, and all you have to do is land on something on French soil or rocks, and you just have to be fully out of water. And...
Well done. Hey, well done, John.
Yeah, come on, just to me. Yeah.
I was like a walrus. I was on the rock, and the waves were smashing me, and I was trying to stand up, but my quads were so sore, I couldn't stand up. So I was hoping he didn't want me to stand up, but I heard the siren go, which means, you know, you're officially finished, and I just kind of rolled back into the water and floated back to the boat. And
3 hours into our nap, we get a call from the satellite phone, and it's Steve Cummings. He says, we're coming in, we're half an hour away, we're on our way to Boulogne, make sure you get there as soon as possible. John's not in a great state. So we pick up, basically rush off to Boulogne to get to John.
Johnny, watch your head, Johnny. Alec, move round here. Johnny, hold that with you.
What up, mate?
Alec, come back.
Lovely to see. Right, have you got him,
Mick? Give me that, Alec.
Got him.
Right.
Straighten the car, put the heater on.
Captain? Yeah, lay him down or sit him down.
No, okay.
What do you want to do, John?
Put him in the front. I don't think we've got room.
I'll lay this back. Push it back in.
Let me get him again.
As soon as he stepped off the boat, after we gave him a hand out, I just knew that this man was literally on the verge of collapse. And I grabbed one arm and John Locko took the other arm and we just literally carried him up the ramp towards the car. I had no idea what a dead weight I was carrying at the time, and unbelievable to think the kind of trauma he'd put himself through going across that channel at the time.
He's obviously totally spent. Absolutely exhausted to the point where he can't hold his head up, his head's rolling around, he can't focus his eyes, and my first thought was, oh my God, we've killed him.
Seeing him virtually unconscious, I guess you could say, not non-responsive, was heart-wrenching,
Obviously I'm in a fatigued state, so I'm kind of half-conscious, half-unconscious, because I know I'm trying to rest my body up, and I know I've got to still lift my legs to get to the hotel, and I've still got to get in the car and things, so I've only got enough energy on to be functional.
Just lean out if you can, lean out the window.
How he got across that quickly on a day that he'd swam in was brilliant. Without a doubt, he really had to dig deep in the beginning. We're taking him back to Calais. He can rest up to a maximum of 12 hours before he has to start the bike.
We had the media going off. People were calling us left, right and centre. Radio stations wanting to interview us. TV stations wanting to do a story. And basically it was really hard at that time to keep in contact, let alone make sure he's safe. And we had so much on our plate at the time. Our best interest was just looking after John at the time. John's advised us, don't call a doctor. He doesn't want anything to do with a doctor because they might tell him, you can't go on, there's no way.
We've got him in bed now. We try to nourish him as best we can after the swim, but sometimes the body doesn't want to take it. But we've looked after him with hydration and nourishment as best we possibly can. He's now in a very deep rest on his bed, and he'll probably sleep between 8 to 10 hours.
I don't think there's anybody else on the planet that could run 140 kilometres in under 16 hours and then stand up 8 hours later and be ready to take another punishment for 12 hours. It's just incredible what he did.
And he's aiming for a 12-14 hour ride into Paris. No one will ever get this. He's the greatest endurance athlete of all time, anywhere bar none. And if he's not and I'm wrong, then you've got to tell me who is.
Well, this is incredible. You saw last night how John Van Wees was helped off the boat. He looked punch drunk. He looked like he'd been in the ring with Muhammad Ali for 15 rounds. They got him to bed, they rested him. He had 12 hours to recoup and get ready and get on the bike. If he went over 12 hours, he'd be disqualified. Unbelievably, after 6 hours, he's got up and says, right, I'm ready to ride. Everyone else is asleep, so everyone else has been panicking, getting ready. John is getting his bike, getting it ready for the start. This is unbelievable. He's catching everybody by surprise. He is Superman.
I was first up, and there's no way I'm not going to feel any better 4 hours later than I was then. I was functional. Once you're functional, let's just go, and you know, ready to go. Let's get going, and the clock doesn't stop.
First person up next morning, 6:30, 7 o'clock. John Van Wisser ready to go. We're still in bed. He's preparing to go. So The recuperation of the man was incredible. To see him walk up that gangplank after his swim and then to see him ready to ride that bike, he had to be back in the saddle before the expiration of 12 hours. In fact, he was back in the saddle before the expiration of, say, maybe 7 hours. It was unbelievable. He's ready to go.
Stage three of the Enduro Man event. In 2 minutes' time, John Van Wisser begins the third leg after having smashed the run and smashed the swim. He goes to the start and he's on his way to the Arc de Triomphe. Go, Johnny! Go,
go, Johnny!
Good luck.
Away the way!
Go, have fun! Go, Johnny! Woo!
Hi, Johnny!
Massive headwind.
Yeah. Going all right, Johnny? Massive headwind.
Took off, and it was a massive headwind. And I remember we stopped at a Macca's in Boulogne, just craving salt and sugar and fat. And my throat was still really sore, so I wanted something quite mushy.
Just walking into McDonald's in St. Leonard, and he's a great man himself. Johnny, mate, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Yeah, good. Yeah. 2 hours into the ride, John. Feeling
yeah,
good. Enjoying the food.
That went quick.
Enjoying it?
Right, it's a massive headwind.
Oh. Massive headwind all the way?
Over in the hills. Oh.
Yeah.
It wasn't over yet.
Now, Johnny, be probably fair to say you're happier at this stage of the event than you've been at any stage of it. Like,
yeah,
2 hours in the run, 2 hours into the swim.
As long as the it's not like a wind, it's like this the whole way.
Yeah.
They'll make it tough. But I actually like a bit of rain.
Yeah.
Johnny, nuggets for you, mate.
Oh, thanks, Dad.
Now, listen, Johnny, will you leave some of those nuggets for me? Because I'm strong.
Got on
you.
Bag
on you, mate. Cheers, John. Got on you, pal.
The first 40K took 2 hours. I couldn't believe how slow it was. So I was thinking, oh, this is ridiculous. You know, it was massive hills and big headwinds. And I thought, oh, no, I hope it's not, I hope the whole ride's not like this. We just presumed it, you know, it was undulating at worst. And like I said, never presume anything in life. And, you know, it was a really tough bike course, which looking back, I'm glad it was, because that makes all three legs fair. You know, it doesn't advantage, you know, a runner or a swimmer or a cyclist, all three legs are hard, and I think that's part of the appeal of it.
Well over the halfway mark, we've got another 80 miles to go, and just had his bike adjusted, he's been refueled with a bit of coughing, and he's feeling really strong.
And your purpose on the street now is to guide him.
I am the gendarme of the road.
Yeah, we've taken over the streets. Down here, John. Down here.
Alejandro.
And there we go, Johnny. On his way to establishing a record for Enduro Man, Johnny making his way up the last killer hills.
So 50, 60 kilometres roughly from Paris. John's body's breaking down. He's really roughing it out at this moment. He's pushing as hard as he can. And I get this text message from Tammy, his sister, saying, can you show this to John privately? So basically it was a message to John saying that I know you're doing this for Dad, and you're doing really well, and he'd be so proud of you, and basically you're the most incredible athlete in the planet right now. And I looked into John's eyes, and it really got him going. It got him up and about, and I think that might have carried him the last 50, 60 kilometres to Paris. So yeah, it's quite amazing, actually.
He has, I guess, a huge emotional investment in this particular event as well, because our father passed away in 1999, so 2 years after we'd initially had thought about doing this particular event. So I knew the whole time that John was over there and doing this event that would be something that was always in the back of his mind, thinking about Dad. And you know, how he's fulfilling a dream. I guess that started with Dad many, many years ago. I actually sent a couple of messages through to John, because I said, Dad would be so proud of you. And I know Dad would be really proud.
Tommy sends you a text saying, Luke, I know you're doing this. Your dad would be so proud of you.
Oh, I mean, yeah. I mean, I worship my dad. Whenever I'm hurting, you know, I just think of him sitting behind a machine. You know, he's the reason why we got here.
So, yeah, you know, not many people know this, but 1997, you and your sister and your dad devised this ultra triathlon. You'd heard about this thing, and you was going to do it in 97, wasn't you?
Yeah, we're thinking about doing it ages ago, and it just, we never got the funding, so it fell through. I was doing 100k training runs, and dad was, you know, mum and dad, well, I got great parents, and you know, they sacrificed a lot for us, and you know, dad would stand behind a printing machine all day and fund our events, and you know, so I was, you know, whenever I'm hurting, I was thinking about him standing behind a machine.
Going beautifully, Johnny.
Thanks, enough.
You want water or anything?
No.
Good. Going, John. Looking good.
Thanks, eh? It's taking us a long way.
It's just a complicated roundabout. I need to lead him round the roundabout, and then he's going to head down some little country lanes through Attenvale and stuff.
Okay, sir.
Fantastic.
Thanks,
see you guys
mate.
Later.
See you.
Thanks a lot.
See you at the finish line.
See you at the finish line, Johnny.
John Van Wyss is just at the Arc de Triomphe. He's nearly finished. It's the last red light, I should imagine, before we get to the finish. He's on his way again.
Once you're going into Paris, you're getting stuck at all the lights. So you can't really go that hard because you get to one light, you ride for a minute, you stop, you ride for a minute, you stop. So you're not really like sprinting into the finish. So I was quite fresh when I finished and knew it was coming and got to see all the monuments on the way for the last hour.
Johnny! Johnny, where is he? Down here?
Johnny,
come on! Johnny, great man! It's Johnny, John Van Wyss, the Enduro man! Johnny! Johnny! Three cheers for John, go on, John! Give us a bit of a speech now, what he's done, come on.
Ladies and gentlemen, he's just ran from London down to Dover, swam across the English Channel and cycled all the way to Paris. He's number 18, he's the fastest man in the world at this moment of time. Johnny! He is Enduro Man, the fastest man.
John Van Wyss from Australia ran down in 15 hours and 53.
Yep.
He swam the channel in 12 hours 31, which is the second fastest channel swim of all time for Enduroman. And he cycled up here in 14 hours and 7. And he's got a total time, world record time, beating the previous record holder by over 12 hours, 61 hours and 27 minutes.
John, who is this now? Tell us who the great.
Right, I've said it all along, and I'm talking the truth. He's the greatest endurance athlete of all time anywhere on the planet. And if you reckon he's not, you tell me who he is and I'll have the debate with you. Because he is the greatest of all time. Ali was the greatest at what he did. We loved Ali and I'm sure Ali loves what this bloke has done. Good on you, Muhammad. We love you.
The Enduroman world champion.
So Edgar, what, you know, it's all finished now. You must be very proud of what's happened.
Oh, absolutely delighted. That's why I do what I do. I love it. And to see somebody like John get it, brilliant. Best thing ever. He's cycled well. He's here. He's fit and strong. And he is an enduro man. We love it.
And that's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about. He's part of the family. Yeah. He's actually the fastest man in the family, but he is part of the enduro
man. So being an Englishman.
Being an Englishman, yeah.
an Australian winning the Ashes of the Enduro Men. The challenge is out now for
it
a
is,
pom.
It is. We'll have to dig somebody up. Hey? We'll have to dig somebody up.
Look, all I could feel was just immense relief and just so excited that he finished and so proud. Very, very proud of him to have completed something that he set about thinking about doing in 1997. It's something that few people on this planet could do.
Yeah, I'm worried that, you know, I'll be 50 years old and someone gets a perfect day or whatever and beats my time, and I'll be too old to defend myself, and I'll be like a whinging old man saying I could have done this, could have done that. So I want to go back and try and get a better window and see if I can, you know, lower it a fair bit, and then I think I'll be happy.
I know John Van Wissel wants me to warmly and specifically congratulate this man. He's the man that conceptualised the event. He was the first man to do it. He did it in 81 hours with half the crew that we had. In fact, he did it with very little assistance, and he was so generous in his support of John. He wanted John to succeed. He wanted John to break the record. He did everything he could possibly do to help John. So on behalf of John and the team, congratulations to you.
And what do you think about Uncle John doing such a big triathlon?
Well, it was good.
Thank you. It was good?
I'm going back. Yeah.